Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame, bésame mucho, que tengo miedo a perderte, perderte otra vez. Quiero tenerte muy cerca, mirarme en tus ojos, vente junto a mí. Piensa que tal vez mañana yo ya esté lejos, muy lejos de ti. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Bésame mucho, aquí tengo miedo a perderte, perderte después.
It is my pleasure to welcome each of you to the Lake Tupala Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. My name is Lou Crippen, and I am your service leader for today. Michael Reason will deliver the message entitled A Melody for Change. Our minister, the Reverend Matt Alspaugh, is taking a well-deserved few weeks off in North Carolina. Some of us are bringing our best selves to this space, and some of us are bringing our struggling selves, including pieces we might be ashamed of. All of us are welcome here, and all of us are loved. Some of us already have open hearts, and some of us aren't quite there yet because our hearts have gotten a little beat up this week and might have forgotten how to trust and open. Your heart is welcome here, no matter how bruised. We welcome you among us. All of us are imperfect, but we're here to drop our defenses and trust that what happens in worship is powerful and life-giving. Together, we affirm that this day and our being together can make each of us braver, more compassionate, and wiser than when we woke up this morning. We welcome you here. And I offer a special welcome to you if you are newly with us this morning. We are honored by your curiosity and presence. We invite you to stay with us for discussion afterward. In studio, along with Michael and myself, we have Roy Haynes, Kat Barnett, Jan Manning, and Charlie Jacobs, assisting and participating remotely, Richard Clark, Trudy Crippen, Colleen Beery, Paula Odom, and Pam Cusionel, providing remote tech support. And so I just want to welcome you with, live from Fellowship Hall, it's our LCUUF Sunday service. Our announcements were up on a slideshow before the service, and the link will be attached in Matt's daily sharing if you were not able to get them written down. However, I have a special announcement from the board. The board has revived our Share the Basket program with a donation to Food Bank Lakeside in July. We plan to continue donations of 5,000 pesos or more each month to organizations providing food support to the local community. We are asking the congregation to donate to this program, separate from your pledge payment. If we collect more than 5,000 pesos in any month, the full amount will be donated to one of the organizations providing food to the local community. If we collect less than 5,000 pesos in any month, the balance will be subsidized from our treasury, as long as this is financially feasible. You may donate to Share the Basket by any of the usual ways: PayPal, bill pay from your U.S. bank, or pesos in cash. Be sure to identify your donations as being for the Share the Basket program.
Good morning. Good morning. The opening words today are from the well-known novelist Nick Hornby, and he says, "I love the relationship that anyone has with music, because there's something in us that is beyond the reach of words, something that eludes and defies our best attempts to spit it out. It's the best part of us, probably."
Our chalice lighting words are by Philip Randall Giles. We kindle this flame as a symbol of the light we would keep glowing in our lives, of appreciation for those who differ, loving kindness for those who suffer, esteem for all who remind us of our heritage and calling us agents of the Most High. Please light your chalice. Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. We do this by sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives. If you have a joy or a sorrow to share today, you can also type it into the chat and we'll try to read those aloud. Now let us recall our concerns and sorrows. Whatever you or the world may be holding, that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts. You are welcome to type other sorrows and concerns in the chat box. Let us begin by recalling the joys, whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others. You are welcome to type joys into the chat box. I have a joy from Colleen Berry. My sister, brother-in-law, have lost, tested negative for COVID. Waiting for my mom's results after her caregiver tested positive. Mild cases all around. And I have a concern that came in from Dee Dee and Larry. To Michael Williams, Larry and Dee Dee's son-in-law, who appears to have COVID. He is with his wife in Virginia. This candle, provided by our care team, represents those sorrows that are too raw, too difficult for us to share aloud. We will light this candle for those sorrows which remain present but left unspoken.
Our first reading today is from the very well-known American folk song singer and social activist, Pete Seeger. Once upon a time, wasn't singing a part of everyday life as much as talking, physical exercise, and religion? Our distant ancestors, wherever they were in the world, sang while pounding grain and paddling canoes, or indeed walking long journeys. Can we begin to make our lives once more all about peace? Finding the right song and singing it over and over is a great way to start. And when one person taps out a beat while another leads into the melody, or when three people discover a new harmony they never knew existed, or a crowd joins in on a chorus as though to raise the ceiling a few feet higher, then they also know there is hope for the world. Our second reading is taken from Sing Your Song by Alan Cohen. Your soul has its own song. Your unique energy and purpose are expressed through your talents, passions, and visions. When you're in touch with your joy and act upon it, your heart feels full and your life is rewarding. When you're disconnected from your passion, you feel empty. Your life is frustrating, and you wonder what you're doing here. Yet even when you're distracted by the fears and troubles of the world, your song still lives inside you. Its tune is etched upon your soul more deeply than any experience could be. As you move through difficulties, detours, or setbacks, your spirit guides you from within, urging you to carry on and emerge shining. In the face of a great challenge, your inner knowing comes forth in unprecedented power. All of your life lessons help you get back in touch with the music of your soul. Others may try to influence you to sing their song rather than yours. If you do, you'll become resentful and lose your voice. To regain it, get back in touch with your truth and act on it.
Never deny your expression for another's. You can harmonize with and support someone else, but don't do it at the expense of your own happiness. You serve others by reminding them of their song. Judgment, punishment, and power plays don't correct. They only drive human beings further from their joy and aggregate pain and self-defeating behavior. When someone is in distress or conflict, help them remember who they really are, and they'll have no need to hurt others. Authentic self-expression begins healing, release, and relief. Remember your song, and you'll become magnetic and compelling. You'll find peace within yourself.
Music throughout history has often reflected social and political changes. This has certainly become more prevalent since the beginning of the 20th century. What you just heard was an excerpt from the Czech composer Antonín Dvořák's Ninth Symphony, one of the most beloved works in the orchestral repertoire. Composed in 1893, it is tuneful, pleasant, and musically very comfortable. Perhaps a reflection of the world that the composer found himself in. With the turn of the century, major advances in industrialization and society started to happen. The development of the automobile and the achievement of manned flight are but two inventions that contributed to a changing rhythm of society. Music followed rapidly, reflecting a new forward momentum. 20 years after Dvořák's comfortable and tuneful New World Symphony, the world heard this. The first performance of Stravinsky's music for the ballet The Rite of Spring in 1913, an excerpt of which you just heard, created a riot in the theater. This barbaric, dissonant, and violently rhythmic music was just so overwhelming for the cultured Parisian audience. The sounds and power of increased industrialization were being reflected in music, pushing traditional harmonic and melodic creativity to its limits. The cliff edge was finally reached after the horrors of the First World War. A new world order and the immense change to society that followed the end of the war contributed to the complete breakdown of tonal music. The Austrian composer Arnold Schoenberg finalized this breakdown of tonality by eschewing traditional composition and creating a technique of composing that was basically mathematical in design. For each piece, he created a theme, or as he called it, a row, comprising of the 12 tones of the chromatic scale. The theme would only use each tone once in any order desired. What followed would be a musical development of this theme throughout the duration of the composition. The result was the complete dissolution of 300 years of traditional music composition. Did anyone hear the melody? Fortunately, this mathematically induced compositional style did not endear itself to too many followers and eventually would fall out of fashion. Both Stravinsky and Schoenberg created music that was a reflection of the society in which they lived. But in the coming decades, music would turn around from being reflective to a driving force for change, both politically and socially. This, of course, probably requires a week's worth of talks to cover it all. So instead, I will take three examples to illustrate how music in the 20th and 21st centuries facilitated change. The 20th century saw the development of more genres of music than the previous four centuries put together. What helped this was the development of radio, records, and television. These technological advances quickly made the world a much smaller place, and music could be distributed on a much larger scale. It is not surprising, therefore, that music had the potential to affect change. The first example I would like to share goes back to 1939, and one song that in many ways started a movement that continues to this very day. Until the late 1930s, music hadn't directly confronted the issues of racism and segregation. Then along came Billie Holiday's recording of Strange Fruit. The founder of Atlantic Records, Ahmet Edergun, called it a declaration of war and the beginning of the civil rights movement. The song is a stark depiction of black bodies hanging from a tree after a lynching. Back then, popular song wasn't a place for brutal truths, and Holiday would have been well aware of the trouble Strange Fruit would create. She later described the audience reaction when she first performed the song. "There wasn't even a patter of applause when I finished. Then a lone person began to clap nervously. Then suddenly, everyone was clapping."
Southern trees bear strange fruit.
blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant south. The bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolia, sweet and fresh. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh.
The song went on to sell over 1 million copies. The clue to its power is the way the lyric simply describes the scene, making us, the listener, take it at face value. Without suggesting solutions or even to inform of the extent of the problem, Strange Fruit simply instills feelings of disgust and deep sadness. Many of those affected by the song went on to march together in support of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And their grandchildren are now doing the same for the Black Lives Matter movement. There is no doubt that Strange Fruit had an immense impact on the way people thought about race, and in no small way helped to create a change in racial attitudes. Societal change and prejudicial attitudes would come front and center when Berry Gordy founded Motown Records in 1959. Berry's label really showed how music could change people's perceptions and make political statements that would contribute to the anti-war and anti-poverty movements of the late 60s and early 70s. Under Gordy's leadership, black artists were given opportunities that just a few years before would have been unthinkable. The creative, soulful pop of Motown artists like Smokey Robinson, The Temptations, and the Jackson 5 won hearts, not just in the United States, but around the world. Suddenly, closed minds were opened to the idea that African-American musicians were just as worthy of attention as their white counterparts. Oh, sorry. I hope you're all dancing like me. Boy, when I hear music like that, I just can't stop moving. But as its artists matured, Motown released music that went beyond pop and into the realm of social and environmental awareness, political protest, and a re-energizing of black pride.
in me. All things ain't what they used to be. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Oh, mercy, mercy me, mercy. All things ain't what they used to be. Oil wasted on the oceans and upon our seas. Fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. Our things ain't what they used to be. Radiation underground in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby are alive. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be. What about this overcrowded and how much more to use from men? Can't you stand?
The groundbreaking work by this generation of African-American artists would continue through to the 21st century with rap and hip-hop. Now, music has also made leaps and bounds for gender equality. The past 30 years have seen a long history of songs that have stood up for women's rights. But back in 1963, this particular song felt shocking to many as the image of the subservient woman gets turned on its head.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. I'd never say.
When I first heard the song, Gore would later say, I was 17, and feminism wasn't quite a going proposition yet. My take on the song was, I'm 17, and what a wonderful thing to be able to stand on a stage and sing to everyone that you don't own me. Gore's spirit has lived on through every woman who has ever decided they wouldn't be told what to do by men. Promoted musically through the likes of Aretha Franklin's R.E.S.P.E.C.T. and to the inspiring pop of the Spice Girls and Destiny's Child. Just imagine young girls all over the world in 1996 watching slack-jawed as the Spice Girls ran amok in some dusty mansion, somersaulting across deserts and making snooty old men blush, all the while singing about female friendship and empowerment.
Stay!
I'm still dancing away to the Spice Girls. Gee, I miss the Spice Girls, don't you? Yes, it was songs like Wannabe that had the effect of making young women the world over more determined that they would not be ignored. It's a spirit that today is exemplified by the likes of Lady Gaga and Taylor Swift. Powerful women seizing total creative control and bending the music industry and society to their vision. Now, I think that music can be considered just about the fastest acting agent of change on society imaginable. A song has the ability to turn the status quo on its head. This can be seen very clearly in the changing attitude towards human sexuality in the 1970s and 1980s. Of course, there have been artists before the 70s performing material that touched on same-sex attraction. You can go back to 1928, when the pioneering blues singer Ma Rainey recorded Prove It On Me Blues with these lyrics. Went out last night with a crowd of my friends. They must have been women, because I don't like no men. Wear my clothes just like a fan. Talk to gals just like any old man. Because they say I do it, ain't nobody caught me. Sure gotta prove it on me. It was, however, two decades from 1970 where artists and their music managed to bring LGBTQ lifestyle into mainstream culture, and consequently an acceptance of it by a wider society. Song, Stonewall Nation, dates back to 1971 and was written and performed by Madeline Davis. Davis is a lifelong gay rights activist and wrote the song after attending her first gay civil rights march. The song, widely regarded as the first gay liberation record, and its uncompromising lyrics, which demand freedom rather than just acceptance, celebrate the resilience and potential power of radical gay activism. On the other side of the Atlantic, a year later in 1972, David Bowie would shock Britain with a live performance of Starman on the hugely popular Thursday evening show Top of the Pops. With the conservative British public still not used to the idea that homosexuality was now legal in England and had been since 1967, Bowie created an outrage at 2 minutes and 17 seconds into the song by draping his arm around guitarist Mick Ronson. We can't really imagine how Bowie's actions could offend anyone, but back then the BBC was bombarded with complaints. The indignation of parents would only endear the otherworldly Bowie to their children. For the generation that would spawn the out gay pop stars of the 1980s, Bowie's outrageous campery and sexual androgyny, gosh, I've got a trouble saying that, was a revelation. And for many watching on that Thursday evening, life would never be quite the same again. Bowie paved the way for so many artists whose music made a contribution to the LGBTQ movement. Artists like Prince and Madonna were the Bowies of the 80s. And today, we have musicians such as Sam Smith, Melissa Etheridge, Adam Lambert, and Brandi Carlile, who are openly gay and proud of it. Music really did make a huge change to society's acceptance and understanding that there is no normal to sexual orientation. Finally, if there was one musical event that changed the entire world, then it must have been the one held on Saturday, July the 13th, 1985, exactly 25 years ago. In October 1984, the BBC transmitted a report showing images of hundreds of thousands of people starving to death in Ethiopia. Michael Burke, the reporter, described it as a biblical famine of the 20th century and the closest thing to hell on earth. The report shocked the UK. It also shocked Bob Geldof, the lead singer of the Boomtown Rats. And in an effort to help the starving population, persuaded many of his musical contemporaries to collectively record a single called Do They Know It's Christmas, under the all-embracing group name of Band Aid. The record became the fastest-selling single ever in Britain and raised $14 million for the relief effort. Emboldened by the success, Geldof and his fellow organizers, Midge of U2 and Boy George of Culture Club, set their sights on a massive concert event that would be held simultaneously in the UK and the US. The result was Live Aid. Many of the most famous musicians across the globe donated their service to perform at the concerts. On the same day, concerts inspired by the initiative were held in other countries, including the Soviet Union, Australia, Canada, Japan, and West Germany. It was one of the largest scale satellite link-ups and television broadcasts of all time. An estimated audience of 1.9 billion across 150 countries watched the live broadcast. That at that time was nearly 40% of the world's population. At the event's core was music. And in raising $127 million on that one day, the world collectively came together with a humanitarian consciousness for the disaster happening on the African continent. How many famous artists did you spot in that short clip? After the event, Bob Geldof ultimately said, "We took an issue that was nowhere on the political agenda, and through the lingua franca of the planet, which is not English, but rock and roll, we were able to address the intellectual absurdity and the moral repulsion of people dying of want in a world of surplus." During the past 30 minutes, we have, in a small way, explored how music has transformed from not only being a reflection of society's changes, but also as a vehicle capable of influencing political agendas, human attitudes, and sexual freedom. I am well aware that there are a multitude of artists and songs that could have been included in this presentation, and perhaps during the breakout groups after the service, we could discuss some other examples of music that helped to create a change in society. Finally, I would like to leave you with one final video that shows how, even after 50 years since its release, a song can still have power and meaning to a society that still needs to find its way through the challenges it faces. The classic song, What's Going On by Marvin Gaye, truly encapsulates both in 1972 and now in 2020, where we will always need a melody for change.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? Oh, but who would they judge us simply 'cause our hair is long? Come on, talk to me so you can see what's going on. Yeah, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. I'll tell you what's going on. Ooh. Right on, right on.
The closing words today are from the singer-songwriter Victor Crowell. Music can calm a wild beast, and it can cause us to have great reflection to the point of changing and improving our lives. When it comes down to it, ideally, that is what spirituality is about: improving the state of your fellow human being, yourself, and the community at large.
We extinguish the chalice with these words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world.